Everyone should have got a gong up there, you know. They really should have. There were so many acts of bravery there.
So we gave them grenades and we gave them instructions. When the enemy comes, you must throw the first grenade at the enemy and kill yourselves with a second grenade.
Oh, I think killing men at close range was the most horrifying thing to see their eyes just about turn up.
...1942 was a big year for Australia. It was the end of our innocence. The year Australia grew up. When war broke out in 1939... ...Australia had rallied to support Britain in the mother country's European conflict... ...just as we'd done in the First World War 2 decades earlier.
Fellow Australians... ...it is my melancholy duty to inform you officially... that in consequence of the persistence by Germany in her invasion of Poland, Great Britain has declared war upon her, and that as a result, Australia is also at war.
To most Australians, it must have seemed a familiar story. Aussies doing their duty, serving in a war at Britain's behest, on the other side of the world. But Japan's unprovoked attack on the United States Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor in Hawaii in the early hours of December the 7th, 1941, changed all that. In a massive coordinated onslaught, Japan launched its conquest of Asia and the Pacific, and Australia was clearly in its path. For the first time in our brief history, another nation was trying to steal our country from us. It came as a big shock.
The big shock also was that we were unprepared and the public knew it. There are at least two reasons why we were not ready. Firstly, we had sent divisions to the Middle East to fight the Germans there. And secondly, we were relying on what was known as the Singapore strategy, under which Britain would send their fleet to be based at Singapore and to defend Australia. With what forces we did have available, we sent an AIF battalion to Rabaul, and a specially volunteered militia battalion went to Port Moresby. But even so, New Guinea was not defended properly. We had not enough planes, not enough ships, and really people thought that the Japanese would not be moving inland in New Guinea.
By the second half of 1941, the Australian Imperial Forces, known as the 2nd AIF, the first having served in the First World War, were acquitting themselves with distinction in the Middle East. Belatedly realizing a need for more manpower, the army began raising militia battalions.
Our Sovereign Lord the King.
Our Sovereign Lord the King.
In the military forces.
In the military forces.
Of the Commonwealth of Australia.
Of the Commonwealth of Australia.
Volunteers for these battalions joined up to defend the Australian homeland, as distinct from those who joined the AIF and volunteered to fight overseas. It was a distinction which was soon to disappear. One such militia battalion was the 39th. Raised in Victoria in October 1941, the 39th was on board the steamship Aquitania bound for Port Moresby before Christmas that year. The average age of the 39th soldiers was 18 and a half.
I imagine something like Hawaii or Honolulu or something to this effect. Sure, the palm trees were there, so were the mosquitoes and every other disease you could find. Some chaps had the tennis rackets and golf clubs, cricket bats. And one chap I can remember, a little old fella, he should never have been there, never had a tooth in his head. He had a kerosene tin, with a broom handle through it and a couple of strings on it and a violin bow. And he used to play. He played all the way up in the Akutane. He was good. That was our entertainment. Anyway, we got about 3 miles out of Moresby. Very, very hot, very dry, very dusty, very dirty. And I saw something fly up in the air and go into the scrub. So that looked like a cricket bat. A little while later, off goes a golf club. Another golf club, something else, a fishing rod, another golf club, and oh, we were about 6 or 7 miles out, and all of a sudden through the air goes this violin. And it disappeared into the scrub, so we never ever saw that again.
The troops soon found, to their dismay, the preparations for their arrival were virtually non-existent.
Well, we got out to the 7 mile drome, and we never had anything. No tents, no blankets, no mosquito repellent of any sort, no medicine. And we found out that everything on the tramp steams that went up with us, everything had been loaded back to front. And all our equipment we wanted then, food and everything, was underneath.
Around the same time, the Japanese war machine was swinging smoothly into action. The 144th Regiment, raised in the southern city of Kochi on the island of Shikoku, had mobilized and embarked on the Kame Maru, bound eventually for Papua New Guinea. The men of the 144th were seasoned combat veterans, having been blooded in Japan's conflict in Manchuria as early as 1937.
By the time we landed in Papua New Guinea, we'd already fought in China, Malaya, the Philippines, and then in Papua New Guinea. And we thought that New Guinea would be the same as all the other battlefields.
On January the 23rd, the 144th Regiment, which formed the backbone of the Nankai Shatai, Japan's South Seas Detachment, became the first enemy to capture Australian territory when it landed in Simpson Harbour, Rabaul. The invaders swiftly overcame the small Australian garrison there and set about establishing Rabaul as their operational headquarters for their Southwest Pacific conquest. The Japanese strategy was to launch a two-pronged assault on Port Moresby. One by land, over the Kokoda track, a meandering, precipitous native walking path. The other by sea. From there, the Japanese intentions on Australia were clear.
By the middle of 1942, the Australian land forces in New Guinea consisted of commando-type units fighting around Wau, 6 militia battalions at Port Moresby, and 3 more arriving at Milne Bay. The Australian commander in Port Moresby, General Morris, did not want to send his forces away from Port Moresby because, well, the terrain was rough, he had few planes or a few roads, and he just couldn't supply them. But the High Command in Australia ordered him to send forces across the Owen Stanley Mountains to secure an air base at Buna. Morris selected the 39th Battalion, and they set off on foot with native porters to walk the 200 or so kilometres to Buna. They set off one company at a time, one company of about 100 men. Unbeknown to the Australians, the Japanese South Seas force at Rabaul had been ordered to land at Buna, establish a beachhead, and then move over the mountains to attack Port Moresby from the rear. On the morning of the 22nd of July, the Japanese advance party of about 2,000 men landed at Buna and moved rapidly inland towards Kokoda. They'd soon be confronting the lead company of the 39th Battalion, about 100 Australians against 2,000 Japanese.
Our morale was so high as we were to advance to Rabaul and attack and occupy it. The voyage was long and some got homesick and everybody was pretty tired. Even so, we were still high in spirit and left Rabaul for Buna at night in order to capture Moresby. At the time, it was very touching. Looking at the ocean, I was filled with emotion. We left our ship offshore Buna and moved into landing craft in the dark of night to advance. However, we didn't have much knowledge about the Buna area. After landing at Buna, we found the jungle and really had a difficult time.
Nick Doroda was in his village near Buna when the invaders arrived. He relives that moment.
After the Japanese landed at Buna, they soon overcame the small patrols from the Papuan Infantry Battalion and started advancing towards Kokoda. The leading Australian company was moving towards them, one platoon at a time. But after sharp fights, they were driven back, and by the 27th of July, they were defending Kokoda. At this time, the commander of the 39th, Colonel Owen, arrived, and he found that the defenders numbered some 80 men against the advancing 2,000. He asked General Morris in Port Moresby to send reinforcements by air. Morris had only two planes, but he sent the planes off, but when the pilots arrived, they could not see what was going on the ground, and they were ordered to return to base.
Sam Pike was part of the group trying to get into Kokoda by air before the Japanese gained control of the airstrip.
Yes, we flew over Kokoda. We thought we were going to get it the easy way. But the pilot flew around and there were zeros buzzing around and he wasn't very happy about that. So we came back again to Moresby, disembarked, and then we walked back again. It took us 20 minutes to fly over and took us 8 days to walk back.
It has to be remembered that the 39th was a very inexperienced battalion. The soldiers were young, poorly trained, and this was their first battle, although fortunately there was a hard core of very experienced officers. There were several battles for Kokoda, but this was not like Vietnam where soldiers arrived by helicopter. The soldiers had to walk all the way across the Kokoda track from Port Moresby, and if they were wounded, they had to walk back again or somebody else had to carry them.
We set up the ambush on the straight stretch of track, waiting to see these small 5x2, 5x3 men come around the corner. To our amazement, when they did come around the corner, they're a 6 foot or more, and they're wheeling push bikes. And considering what the track was like, we thought that was rather funny.
The initial surge of the Japanese saw them overrun Kokoda, as the Australians fought a courageous campaign of hit-and-run skirmishes.
After capturing Kokoda Hill, we started to attack at the foot of the Mount Stanley, where we encountered very strong resistance from the Australian forces. We spent 3 or 4 days there. We understood that Australian forces withdrew, so we started to advance. Then we saw 3 Australian soldiers set machine gun in position and wait for us. The path we were advancing along was so narrow that we could only march in file. The regimental colors went first, followed by 15 color guards, and they came machine gun fire from their position. 7 or 8 people fell into the valley.
We were heavily outnumbered, and we felt that I was convinced that heavy patrolling was more use and to keep the enemy guessing was hitting them and running and turning back and hitting them behind again and running. If we could do this, we would confuse them to the point of where they would be held up, not knowing just how many troops were against them. The point was subsequently proved on the northern coast when we captured a brigade headquarters documents indicating they thought at the time there were some 6,000 troops against them. And we wouldn't have numbered more than about 110.
When the battle died down, we came out into the open, and there on the ground was a Japanese soldier. He'd taken a burst of machine gun fire. He was almost cut in half. He was in a hell of a mess. The officer said, "Smokey, finish him off." With that, I looked down, and he looked back at me. And I've been looking at those eyes ever since.
Unlike the Gulf War, which was a bit like a computer war, this was an intensely personal war as the soldiers fought man to man as they withdrew up the mountains towards Ishirava, where the battalion would hold out, waiting for the reinforcements to arrive. During the fighting for Kokoda, the commander of the 39th had been killed, and he was succeeded here by Colonel Ralph Honor, who was back from the Middle East where he had a really splendid record. Honor rallied the battalion, waiting for the reinforcements. Firstly, the 53rd Militia Battalion, and then a bit later, the 2nd 14th AIF Battalion, back from the Middle East.
Yes, they were in pretty bad shape because they'd been in action for some of them for about 3 weeks, and all of them to some extent under fire at Kokoda and Deniki before falling back on Isharava. They were worn out not only because of the fighting but because of inadequate food and complete lack of shelter. It rained every day and all night, and so their only chance of sleep was during the daytime when it wasn't raining, and they were not likely to be jumped by an enterprising enemy.
The 2nd 14th Battalion, an AIF unit rushed back from the Middle East, was standing by to relieve the 39th, back down the track at Afogi, awaiting supplies.
We're looking forward to meeting the Japanese over the mountains just ahead of us. And we had little campfires and we had sing-alongs. My brother, who was a platoon commander of 10 platoon, he invited me up from, because I was an intelligence officer of battalion at that stage, from battalion headquarters. So he'd come up and I sang a few songs of his favourites and what his platoon liked. And I can well remember that in those moments while I was singing, I just had that feeling, premonition, that dear old Butch, my brother, whom I loved so much, that he was going to be killed. And it was a strange feeling, but it's something that lived in my memory. And I never dreamt that a couple of weeks later that I'd hold him in my arms at Isharava for about 4 hours while he died, his hand in mine, and we talked about some of our good days and our bad days.
The Battle of Isharava, one of the most ferocious and crucial in the Southwest Pacific Theater, began on August the 26th, when the battered remnants of the 39th Battalion were set upon by an enemy overwhelmingly superior in numbers and firepower.
While the Australians were desperately trying to reinforce the 39th Battalion up there at Isharava, the Japanese had sent the remainder of their force to Papua. And General Horry, commanding the South Seas Force, for the coming battle would have 13,500 Japanese, and 10,000 of these would be combat troops against perhaps 500 Australians.
During the battle, we had advanced about 200 metres. And I remember that an Australian soldier, wearing just a pair of shorts and stripped to the waist, came running towards us, throwing hand grenades at us. And I remember thinking at the time that this was something that would be very hard for a Japanese soldier to do. Even now, when I think about it, I'm affected by the memory of this warrior. I suppose the Australians had a different motivation for fighting, but this soldier, this warrior, was far braver than any in Japan, I think. And when I think about it, now it still affects me.
They should have bypassed us by going along through Naro and along the Naro Ridge to Alola, cut us off from our supplies, our water, and we'd have been finished as a fighting force. They didn't do that, and I think it was a grave lapse on the Japanese commander's part that he did not do that instead of throwing his troops at us where we were dug in and where we could kill them in a ratio of possibly 10 to 1. There is a big advantage for a defence which is built in sitting in weapon pits, firing at people, coming at them and not knowing exactly where they are. I think the Japs lost out
tactically on not wiping the 39th out at Ishiraba. But as for their actual fighting capacity, they were good troops. They were good trained troops, and they were seemingly fearless. Almost fanatical in their fearlessness.
We got a message from Port Moresby that the 2nd 14th were on the way, and they were out to fight to the finish. There was no give in at all. We had to stay there, fight till death. And that was a bit horrifying. And I thought, well, I won't see my family again, I won't see Australia again. But I was prepared, like the rest of us, to just stay there and fight to the finish.
You need a special kind of courage. When you draw your sword and point it forward like that, this is a display of your own courage as well as a signal to the men. It doesn't just mean, right, we are going to attack now. In that sense, it is a signal, but also as a deeply linked to your personality and courage. It's like in music when the conductor raises the button to the orchestra. The same as music, however, instead of raising the baton, you draw your sword and say, charge. You give the order. Obviously, you are not trying to cut the opponent. It's in order to get everybody up and into the attack.
The first reinforcements of the 2nd 14th arrived at Ishiraba on the afternoon of the 26th of August in the nick of time.
We would have been wiped out that evening or the next morning if we had stayed there. And I was going to stay there because the reinforcement was promised. And I was just hoping like hell it was coming, because if it hadn't come, we'd have been done. I couldn't implement a plan of withdrawal in the face of an incoming reinforcement. We had to stay. They had to get to us. The rest of the 2nd 14th arrived on the 27th and 28th of August, but by that time there were four battalions of Japanese attacking us, and I advised Brigadier Potts, who had taken command of Maroubra Force, that I couldn't leave the 2nd 14th alone to face them, because it was more than enough for one battalion. So our fellows had been promised relief for the past week and were ordered out, were then ordered to stay on.
When I arrived, we saw what was left of the 39th. We'd heard what they'd been through, and I was personally surprised to see that men who looked so down and out could come back for more. They were volunteering to stop with us. And we were gratified, because we needed every person. Anyone that could hold a rifle or a gun was needed. And it was amazing the way the two sides of the Australian Army came together without let or hindrance. It was encouraging. It was a morale booster.
The 39th, seeing the arrival of the 2nd 14th Battalion originally, blokes nearly twice as big as themselves, and well armed, well equipped, and ready for a fight. They thought they were, one bloke said, I thought they were gods.
The selfless devotion of the 39th set the tone for a monumental struggle in which both sides fought themselves to a standstill.
The platoon consists of a lieutenant, a sergeant, a runner, and three corporals and 27 other ranks, which is a total of 33 people. We were on a ridge forward of the rest of the company, and the Japs were hammering us with machine guns and lopping all the undergrowth away, which was our cover, until such time as we were completely denuded and there we were exposed to them entirely. We'd more or less just taken over from some boys from the 39th Battalion, and the Japs started coming up the hill towards us, and I can remember we threw, I would say, about 100 grenades into them, and they eventually overran us, and it was at this stage that we were completely more or less decimated. There were the final result was there were 14 killed and 18 wounded in our platoon. I can't remember who the bloke was that wasn't touched, but, you know, they completely wiped our platoon out.
I remember that all my junior officers, my NCOs, and most of my men lost their lives. Accordingly, all we could think of doing was leaving the place we were in and attacking up the hill, and we are being told by the officers from behind, attack, attack. So there was no courage. Just without thinking, we attacked and attacked.
Everyone should have got a gong up there, you know. They really should have. There were so many acts of bravery there. Now, fella, there's a Jap, he jumped into a foxhole there once and he bit a bloke's big lump out of his jaw. The combat was that close, you see.
It was in this cauldron, just when the Japanese appeared set to overrun his platoon, that Private Bruce Kingsbury joined the Immortals.
We were in danger of being overrun for a long time, you see. When I say a long time, a half an hour of that action is a long time, you see. It wasn't a day and a half or a day or anything like it, but half a day. It's a wonder anybody survived, you know, because of the gunfire, because there was so much of it from both sides. The place was absolutely just flattened. But Bruce did come out and take over and sort of just cleared the way. There were clumps of Japs here and there, and he just mowed them down.
We'd lost our platoon sergeant and the platoon commander, and personally I'd been hit in the nose with a piece of shrapnel that hit my tooth here and flew up into my nose, and I had blood everywhere, all over my shirt, and as I looked at myself I thought I was going to die, but then I realised I wasn't, and so I was able to continue on. And then during the fight that I've just described, I was hit twice in this leg down below, and that almost incapacitated me. I was having trouble walking then. And I still had this Bren gun, and the handle of the Bren gun was so hot I couldn't handle it, so I had to grab the tripod underneath. And then I reached the stage where I just couldn't go any further. I was physically exhausted, I couldn't walk, I couldn't do anything, so I had to go back. And I handed the gun over to a man by the name of Bruce Kingsbury.
I reckon he almost gave his life away because you're so... there's nothing scared about it. He just went straight into him as if bullets didn't mean anything, you know. And we all got a bit of the action, you see, when we saw him. Well, and when you see a thing like that, you sort of follow the leader, don't you? And that's what we did, but he did a marvellous job.
Bruce Kingsbury was killed by a sniper at the moment of his glory. He was to become the first to win a Victoria Cross on Australian territory. But despite the diggers' resolute resistance, the Japanese pressed on relentlessly, suffering fearful losses.
Just in front of one of the key positions on the higher ground, where my brother, Butch, had his platoon, 10 platoon, and Mocker Tracy, who was subsequently awarded the MC, he had 11 platoon. They in turns occupied this position, and they withstood something like 30 or 40 separate attacks by the Japanese company and two company attacks. And when our chaff force came through some weeks later, when the Japanese were forced to withdraw, they counted 350 graves in front of this position. So for 350 killed, there would be at least 1,000 that would have been wounded. So these are casualties that just two platoons of our battalion inflicted.
Although the Australian defenders took a massive toll of the Japanese, the besiegers' superiority in numbers meant the result of the contest was inevitable, and the Australians were forced to make a fighting withdrawal to avoid being overrun and annihilated. The Fuzzy Wuzzy Angels, as the diggers called the Papuan stretcher bearers, provided an invaluable service to the beleaguered diggers, taking supplies and ammunition to the front and bringing the wounded back on stretchers.
The carriers provided our only lifeline, in for supplies and out for the wounded. And they were overworked and overloaded, and many of them died on the job. With the wounded, they were absolutely devoted to the task, and I think someone spoke of their devotion as being like the care of a nurse and the love of a mother.
Without the Fuzzy Wuzzy Angels, many more diggers would have died on the track. Indeed, if a wounded or sick digger couldn't walk out, it was either a Fuzzy Wuzzy stretcher or death.
They go right up the front line, and we hunted over them, and they carry all that ruggy down up in Kokoda. They all came back with rain, even raining on carriers, done a good job, and I saw it with my own eyes. And the carrier should be respected, you know, like the army.
When the 39th Battalion was eventually given a break from the front line, the survivors rallied at Minari, a tiny village about halfway down the track. The legendary Australian cinematographer Damien Parra was there to record the moment.
At Minari the next morning, I received a message from Potts congratulating the 39th on the job they'd done under his command and asking me to pass that message on to the 39th. So I had my first battalion parade at Minari.
We did our best to put on a good front, although some of us hadn't eaten for a long time. We had odd boots, some had split boots. We all had sticks to help us climb through the mud. So we had dysentery. I didn't even have a weapon. Matter of fact, I didn't have a Dixie or a mess tin to have my meal. But we proudly tried to do our best to stand our attention for a colonel honour.
The campaign now hung in the balance. The real cause for the near disaster on the Kokoda track was a faulty strategic appreciation in Australia. General MacArthur had his eyes on a spectacular offensive against Rabaul. And despite intelligence which showed that the Japanese would possibly come over the Owen Stanley Mountains, neither MacArthur nor General Blamey, commanding the Australian Army, really believed that they would do so. About this time, there was a tendency to panic in some elements of the Australian government, and this put pressure on the senior Australian commanders. MacArthur and Blamey felt that their own positions were under threat. And when things went wrong in New Guinea, they tended to blame the men on the spot. And of course, this has left a legacy of bitterness from the men who were there on the spot.
I can't credit Blamey with any military intelligence. They were given all the information they had, and they refused to accept it if it wasn't what they wanted. They refused to accept that the Japanese were attacking us, and we were holding them against immense odds. And they decided that, or at least MacArthur decided, that they had to publicise that the Australians were retreating. And Blamey accepted that they were running away from inferior numbers. When I came back, I reported to Rowell, and he said, "I'm sending you to Blamey tomorrow morning. He's now, and he's here in supreme command, and he'll want to hear from you." And so I spruced myself up somehow and reported to Blamey the next morning, as all arranged, and said, "Oh, good morning, Honour. You've just arrived in Moresby from Australia, have you?" And I said, "No, sir, I've been in Papua for some time." And we dwindled off onto other topics. The war was never mentioned. The Maroubra campaign, which was in full flight, this is when they were on Brigade Hill and fighting for their lives, a matter of no importance to him. He didn't know who I was. I'd been his commander of the Australian forces opposing the Japs. He didn't know. He didn't care.
The leaders did realise the problems of supplying the frontline troops. They had established an airdrop zone in some dry lakes near the summit of the Owen Stanleys at a place the Australians called Myola.
The bearer line brought in some supplies, but they also supplemented for the first time, I think, with aerial dropping, and that was of course very much a hastily improvised sort of an operation where they weren't hadn't learned how to pack things for dropping and that sort of thing. For instance, small bags of rice or sugar or anything like that were just simply tossed out of the plane. They often burst when they hit the ground, and of course there was an appreciable loss. Later on, of course, they learned to put a small bag inside a bigger bag And then when the small bag burst, well, the bigger bag, of course, saved the loss. But they also dropped some 3-inch mortars to us there, but of course we never saw them. They went into Frobney ground and well, nobody ever found them. And so it was, I think somebody did tell me that there was something like a 40% recovery.
The Australians were by now experienced and effective jungle fighters. Despite their poor preparation, the disparity in firepower and the constant lack of supplies, they had ingeniously adapted to the conditions. The conditions on the trek were as great an obstacle as the enemy. Malaria and scrub typhus were rife, and the grueling stress of battle took a constant toll.
There's 29 balls under my boots, and my socks had rotted off, and I'd cut the jumper out of my sleeves out of my jumper and use those as socks, because we had no dressings or anything. It was just, they're just superating all the time, of course, and that's why whenever I sat down, I used to take my shoes and socks, boots and socks off to let a bit of air in. And one of them in particular, on top of this instep, it was right through from the sole to the top, you know, it was just a hole through. You could put your hand at the bottom or the top and pick up a core, you know. But, you know, you just kept on going, you know, there's nothing you can do about it.
Most of the time, the Australians were forced to endure the savage onslaught of an increasingly desperate enemy as they contested every yard of the jungle killing fields.
Pushing our way through the jungle, we came across heavy fire, and all of a sudden a burst of machine gun came across me and blew the submachine gun to pieces, and that's when I realised I'd been hit. I dropped, and then I realised I'd been hit in more places when I'd lost my arm, been hit under the chin and hit through the chest and the leg. As I left the RAP, I was told by my medical officer, Blue Stewart, that I had no chance of getting back to Moresby, because he didn't think I had any health, that my health was good enough to get there. After him dressing my wounds and amputating my arm, we moved out with four Papuans carrying me, and at that stage, they told me that it would be approximately 5 or 6 days before I got back to Port Moresby. It turned out to be it was 12 days before he got back.
I don't think I'm a hard man, I think I'm a soft man. But you get used to the fact that people are dying around you. And unlike the pictures, they don't die screaming or yelling. They die quietly. They're not moaning and groaning particularly, except unless they're unconscious. And if they're wounded, they usually keep fighting until they do die. They didn't throw their lives away recklessly, but almost calmly, knowing they were doing their duty and going to their death calmly. I particularly think of blokes like Lefty Langridge and Claude Nye, one with a company of the 2nd 16th and one with a company of the 2nd 14th. Who were ordered to go around the right flank where the bulk of the Japanese were to try and force a way through them to Brigade Hill. They knew they couldn't do it. They knew they were going to die. Langridge handed over his pay book and his dog tags to one of his mates. He was a brave soldier. So was Claude Nye. They were both killed. Actually, out of the two companies, about six men got through.
Soon after midday, many Australian soldiers came and fired for more than an hour. Many Australians were killed. Most of us were killed as well. Only eight soldiers survived. The platoon leader was killed, and it's only me who could lead the others eight surviving soldiers. I contacted the headquarters of the 5th Battery behind us. However, no assistance was received. We had to keep our position with only eight of us. Around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, many Australian soldiers came down. By that time, we had lost 7 out of 8. I was the only survivor. I reached for a gun belonging to a dead soldier and prepared for the next fight. This is my helmet. I was wearing this at Effogi when an Australian put the barrel of a Bren gun against my helmet and pulled the trigger. I tried to jump out of the hole I was in. Just as I jumped up, he pulled the trigger and the bullet broke my helmet. But I wasn't shot in the head. I was shot twice in the shoulder. I ripped the strap and threw the helmet away, and the Australian soldier ran away, so I ran after him. And I pulled out my bayonet from my hip, and I stabbed the Australian. I stabbed him here, but it hit his rib bone, and he didn't die. The Australian pulled out the bayonet because it was hurting him, and he kicked me in the stomach. I was thrown head over heels, but I knew that if I didn't do something, I'd be shot. So I grabbed him in bear hug, but I was wounded, so I couldn't use my right arm, so I only used one arm. So I grabbed him with one arm, but he was a big man. He had a bayonet in his belt, so I pulled out his bayonet and I stabbed him with his own bayonet. The Australian soldier said, "Ooh," and fell down. There was a tree, and he was lying down next to the tree like this. Every so often, he would lift his head up and look at me. I had also been shot, and I'd lost a lot of blood, and I couldn't see anymore. I was lying on my back and looking at the Australian. Every time he lifted his head, it sounded as though he was going to get up. So I would start to get up as well. And then the Australian would fall down again, lie down again. And we continued doing this all night, looking at each other and doing our best. When morning came, the Australian soldier was dead.
Corporal Kokichi Nishimura of the 144th Regiment was one of the many whose lives were irreparably affected by the Kokoda track. Amidst the carnage at Effogi, Nishimura-san made a solemn promise.
Those of us who were left promised each other that those who survived would come back after the war and pick up the bones of those who died. I feel the promise is a duty which I must fulfill for the rest of my life. Actually, I have a wife and child, but when I decided to go to Papua New Guinea, my wife and my child opposed this. But I decided to sell off my land, all my assets, cut all my links with my family, and return to Papua New Guinea as a single man, and carry out my promise to my comrades who died in the war.
And that's exactly what Kokichi Nishimura did in 1979. From his tiny base in Popondetta near the track, he has spent the last 12 years honoring his promise to his fallen comrades.
At the Battle of Effogi, my platoon consisted of 42 men. The others all died. At the moment, the only person who came back from the Battle of Effogi is me, and me alone. And because I have the duty to fulfill my promise, I'm still trying hard to keep my promise to my comrades. It's now 40-something years since the fight at Effogi ended, and I've finally been able to start collecting the skeletons. Whenever I go looking for skeletons, all that's left is legs. There's no upper bodies to any of the skeletons. And all the legs always have boots on their feet. I think that maybe they're waiting for me. If I dig a hole next to the feet I find, again I find more legs with no upper body, And again, they've got shoes on. And they're waiting for me. No matter what skeleton I find, there's always only the legs. Only the legs. To me, that means that my friends are waiting for me. The upper bodies have gone, but the legs and the shoes are waiting for me. Because they want me to take them home to Japan.
The 2nd 16th and 2nd 14th battalions continued their gallant rearguard fight until they were down to a handful of fit men. They made their final stand at Iorubaiwa.
It was a dreadful battle in many ways because we'd gone over in our battalion 546 strong, and at that stage we were rapidly reaching our final figure of 90. We were sitting on a forward slope at Iorubaiwa, and the Japs were there with their heavy guns, their infantry weapons and their mountain gun. And one by one they picked our fellas off. And it was a dreadful position to be in. The fellas were tired, and to see their mates just going one by one at every sound of the mountain gun was pretty devastating.
And every shot somebody got killed. I think there were 7 killed on the day. This bloody thing would go off. All you'd hear was crack over your head and duck. It was too late to duck. It was there. Sidney Johnson, I suppose, was the worst hit. He was a band sergeant. Shouldn't have been there at all. But Sid had a hole that size in there. The field dressing, the big one, just sat in it. And Sid said to me, he said, "Dud, save me." And he was talking through there, not through here. He was breathing through there. We got him out, but he didn't survive.
We worked really hard and finally got up to the mountain at Iorubaiwa. We looked down and we could see the sea. We could see the searchlights from Port Moresby. We'd gone more than 90% of the way toward the goal. But our stores had run out. Our rations had run out. The first, the initial plan was for the 144th Battalion to attack. A frontal assault down the hill against the Port Moresby, while men from other units landed from the sea behind Port Moresby. But that plan failed because Guadalcanal was threatened, and the men were sent off to Guadalcanal. Because we couldn't do it, the order was issued to fall back and go back down the track.
The tide of battle had turned, and the Japanese found themselves plagued by the same supply and reinforcement problems which had dogged the Australians earlier. But while the Japanese advance had petered out, the resolve and courage of the individual troops held firm, even under the most extreme pressure, as they fought a withdrawal back to the beaches at Buna and Gona, where they had landed some 2 months before.
The 3rd Battalion was overrun by Australian troops. There were many deaths. Australians came to within 5 meters of the regimental flag. I remember now what they said.
Fire, fire, quick, quick.
I decided the regimental colors were in danger because the enemy had come so close, and so I shouted to the commander of the battalion, "What shall I do with the flag?" And he told me to burn it. It was the custom that whenever the flag was destroyed, the flag bearer had to die with it. Usually, we would put gasoline on the flag and set fire to it with the match, but there was no time. So I saw toward the left there was a hut on fire. So I held the flag and threw gasoline over my steel helmet and onto my body and jumped into the hut. As soon as I jumped into the hut, the flag and myself burst into flames. I intended to die. But as soon as I jumped into the hut, it was extremely painful, and I rolled around on the floor. I fell in the well in the floor, and of course the flame went out. I was no longer burning. It became dark, and when it became totally dark, the Australian troops pulled out. Then the representative of the battalion commander, a man named Shimada, came to me and said, "What did you do with the flag?" I apologized that the flag wasn't burned yet and explained why. And he said, "Bring it with you." I couldn't walk. I couldn't see. I had been burned all over my body. So I asked him to take the flag, and I gave it to him.
Whilst we were there at Imata, after coming down from Irabaila, we got our first sound of one of our own weapons going overhead, a 25-pounder. It was music. We'd been on the receiving end for long enough, and the blokes were feeling pretty downcast about this. We had no things that could send anything back at them, and we'd just spent a few days at Irabaila with this mountain gun hammering away. And the sound of those 25-pounders going overhead was absolutely beautiful. I thought, you little beauties, you know, mix that with your rice, as the great Alan Hattie used to say. He used to have that famous saying, mix that with your rice, you little so-and-sos, as he threw a grenade. And that's what we all thought when the 25-pounder went over.
There were a lot of men who couldn't move, and because we'd been ordered to leave, we had to leave them there. So we gave them grenades and we gave them instructions. When the enemy comes, you must throw the first grenade at the enemy and kill yourselves with the second grenade. And then we left them there and we crossed the river. This is one of my worst memories of the war.
Oh, I think killing men at close range was the most horrifying thing, to see their eyes just about turn up. They're just as frightened of dying as what you and I are frightened of dying. It's not and I think to know that you see a wounded man, then you call on him to surrender and he puts a grenade up to his mouth and pulls the pin out and you shoot him. But he was a helpless individual. You would be prepared to help him. He didn't want your help.
During the advance along the track, we really felt that we had to get to Port Moresby and capture it as quickly as possible. And the troops broke out at each obstacle along the road to break through to Port Moresby, and we really fought hard. However, when we got to Iwodibaiwa, we were told to turn around and go back, and when the retreat began, we just lost our spirit. The withdrawal turned into a dash and escaped down to Girua. On the way through Girua, we held our heads high and felt great. But on the way back, we hung our heads. When things get really bad, when you get no food and you can't do your duty, all that's left is death. But when you get to that stage, something within you comes out and say, "I don't want to die." Some other soldiers talk about the emperor or the spirit, the esprit de corps of the army. But for me, it was my mother, my mom. My thoughts of my mother remained in my heart. My mother said to me before I left, "You mustn't die. Come home. You must come home." So for me, it was my mother.
It took the 7th Australian Division another month before they drove the Japanese South Seas Force back to Kokoda. And then it was a further 2 months before a reinforced corps of Australians and Americans defeated the Japanese in the beachheads at Buna and Gona. Combined with the Guadalcanal campaign, the Kokoda campaign marked the turning point of the war in the Southwest Pacific. No longer would the Japanese be able to pose a direct threat to Australia. Using Port Moresby and the Buna area as a base, the Allies advanced along the north coast of New Guinea, and about a year later, the Japanese cut their losses and went for a strategic defensive in the New Guinea area. In terms of the direct effect on Australia, Kokoda was the most important battle fought by the Australians in the Second World War. And in its general importance to Australia, Kokoda ranks right up there in importance with the legendary Gallipoli campaign.
In the tradition of its forebears, the 144th Regiment fought to the last. Only a small portion of the invading force was able to escape by ship from their Buna Gona beachheads. The Nonkai Shatai's final casualty list was devastating. Perhaps 90% of those who landed in Papua New Guinea never returned home to Japan. The Japanese and the Australians were unyielding foes in the fetid jungles of the Owen Stanleys. But the passing of time has seen the old enemies come together, bonded by a mutual respect and a common desire to ensure their grandchildren never have to endure the horrors of war to which they were subjected. Since 1979, the diggers of the 39th Battalion and the Japanese veterans of the 144th Regiment have held joint commemorative services. Perhaps this alliance, unique in modern warfare, will ensure that the sacrifices of the thousands of young men who never returned from the bloody track will not have been in vain.
In retrospect, we can see that they were just the same sort of people as we were. And I suppose that's one of the stupid things about war, isn't it?
These days, it's something we want to forget. We all want to forget as much as possible. But also, the first thing we should say is you shouldn't have war. And I want to teach my children and my grandchildren war is something that you shouldn't do. To tell the children not to have, not to take part in war, is the duty of we, the survivors.
I think everybody has realized the futility of war for one thing, that it's just, there just isn't anything to be gained by it. And so far as the attitude toward the Japanese were concerned, I've mellowed over the years. I'm afraid I had to, because living up here in Queensland, of course, and jogging down to the coast sometimes on a weekend, you felt that if you didn't mellow, you know, it could be nasty. But yeah, I've mellowed and I realised that they were fighting for a cause, the same as we were.
I don't like politics, and I don't like talking about the war. I think it's very sad, but at the time, we had to fight for Japan. We were told to fight for the nation or for our family, but remembering those men who died, now I really think that it was meaningless. It's very sad.
When I was little, I was lonely and used to take my dog Esu to the beach. As someone told me, the ocean continues to New Guinea, where my father was. Even on rainy days, I stood at the beach with an umbrella up. On Mother's Day, my friends were wearing a red carnation on their breast, but I wore a white one. Every night in bed, grandmother stroked Motoko's hair and cried, saying she should have died instead of father or mother.
Father, I have come to see you. Thanks to your fellow soldiers of the Coach New Guinea Association. I came to see you, Father, after 49 years. I'm very sorry I didn't come earlier. I have elected your tombstone. I will come to see again. Please rest your soul. I want to take you home, Father. Father, I want to take you home.